Joining me now is Dr. Brad Spellberg, Chief Medical Officer at the Los Angeles County University of Southern California Medical Center. Dr. Spellberg, good morning to you.
Good morning.
Let me start here with, we just had the report from Sturgis, South Dakota, with this huge festival, 250,000 potentially bikers and friends hanging out. I want you to listen to Rod Woodruff, and then I want your reaction to it.
I don't mean to make light of it, but I mean to be dang serious about the freedom aspect of that. These are freedom-loving people. They're not going to give it up.
Freedom-loving people getting together and the freedom not to wear a mask. To someone who says that, you say what?
Slapped forehead emoji, I guess. You don't want to be in our ICU. You really don't. And we don't want you to be.
Let me ask you about your ICU, because I understand at the height you had 120 COVID patients, 45 in the ICU. Where are you today?
Well, we're in the 70s total and in the mid 30s in the ICU. So it's better, but not where it needs to be for us to be able to reopen all of our normal services. I do want to emphasize our emergency department remains open. And if you need critical help, if you have an emergency, we definitely are open for business and come see us. But we do need people to stay physically distanced and wear their masks and wash their hands, because this has not gone away and it's going to keep, you know, having periodic surges until the public really starts to take this seriously.
Has there been a change in the profile of the typical patient that you see in your ICU versus March and April to what you're seeing today?
You know, there really hasn't. And I know that this has been a common theme that you've heard about, that people are younger now, people getting it, the average age has fallen. We're a public hospital. Public hospitals tend to take care of younger people at baseline. So we have not seen a substantive change in the age of our patients. We have had young people all along. We've had deaths in their 20s and 30s. We have lots of people in their 20s and 30s get intubated, put on a mechanical breathing machine. And just keep in mind, when you're on that machine, you're on it for weeks, and you have tubes in every orifice. This is not a happy existence, and we don't want people, you know, to have to live like that.
Yeah. You told our producers that in the effort to free up ICU beds and the discussion of capacity, it's not so much the physical bed, it's the nurse. Explain that.
Yeah, that's a great point. People have a misunderstanding about this. We have lots of physical space. I mean, if worse came to worse, we could go out in the parking lot and create an emergency field hospital. We actually have in the hospital the ability to create physically 50 extra ICU beds. But we don't have nurses to staff those beds, and we don't have doctors that are experts in people on breathing machines to take care of people on those beds. The limiting resource is not physical space. It's expertise of staff. And what you don't want is a situation that's occurred in other parts of the world that have been overwhelmed, where wholly unqualified people are managing the sickest patients on these vents and making mistakes.
Yeah. I read that in California, you've got this program. I don't know if it's exclusive to California, but to free up general beds at your facility, you send patients home with oxygen. How's that working? How is it working?
Yeah, this is a really innovative program that we've implemented in the public hospital system in LA County. I'm not sure many other hospitals have this, but we realized very early we were going to be the system that got overwhelmed first as the public hospital system, and we needed to become much more efficient. So what we do is we have instructions, we have an instructional video, we have an educational handout. We give people in the emergency department, or if they're already in the hospital upstairs, they go home with an oxygen tank that we give them. And then our oxygen vendor meets them the next day and keeps replenishing their oxygen. And we give them telehealth visits daily until we know they're safe. And it's been working remarkably well. It's helped us avoid hundreds and hundreds of hospital admissions. And it's saved thousands and thousands of hospital days, helping us stay within our capacity.
After the shortage earlier this in the spring, I should say, the administration confirmed or tried to convince people that there was enough PPE to go around for all the medical professionals. And just this week, the FDA has loosened guidelines related to PPE because of reported shortages in some hotspots. Are you experiencing there in LA County shortages of PPE availability?
We have not had throughout the pandemic in our system a shortage of PPE. There were, you know, our supply chain fought hard to make sure we had access. So I'm not saying this was easy, and it wasn't like the supply chain was steady or reliable, but our system has not had gaps or shortages, and right now we're sitting fairly comfortable with our PPE supply.
Last question, and quickly if you can, what's your concern as we head into, 6 to 8 weeks out from the start of flu season?
Yeah, so people need to remember that the problem is not just the COVID patients. Our other patients need healthcare too. And the winter is when the hospitals are always the fullest because flu knocks people out and causes problems. And so the fear is the convergence of two problems at once could very rapidly overwhelm health systems.
Dr. Brad Spellberg, thank you so much for what you do, and thank you for your time this morning.